countdown to the last comic shop in 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Hey, hey! And it is now time for the last of the comic shops! Ta-da! It's all about the Eisner Awards, or well, it's not really about the Eisner.
No, because nobody agreed to talk for 45 to 50 minutes about Gary Trudeau. And so I am boycotting. Boycotting, I say. Even though we're opening the shop up to newbies to help them find their way underneath this giant comic book Doonesbury of ours.
We're keeping the lights on for the oldies that might know who Gary Trudeau or what a Doonesbury is.
Is he the feather or is that Dan Quayle? Dan Quayle's the feather. Who was the guy with the big long nose? Like, I don't know. There was a guy that, like, his nose was a mile wide. He wore glasses.
Larry King?
He wore suspenders, too. He looked like the dude from Office Space.
You're describing Larry King. The old late night guy.
It's not Larry King. Any case, I'm the host with the most, Andy Larson. I try to be Larry King. I try to put on an interesting podcast for all of you folks to listen to, but I'm stuck with these guys, Jay Scott and Chad Smith, my loyal co-hosts.
I still want to know, what's a Doonesbury? Is it like a schnozberry?
It's the dude's last name, Mike Doonesbury, the main character. That's okay. The guy with the glasses and the nose.
Larry King.
All right. Well, any case, yes, today on today's program, we were going to talk about the Eisner winners. But simply put, we've already had that stuff out on our Twitter page. So if you've checked our Twitter page the last couple of weeks, it's already done. Like, it's not a deal anymore. Like, people won. Go out to our Twitter, at Last Comic Shop. You can see our coverage of everybody that won those awards in the last couple of days. But what I did want to do is, because some folks kind of commented on this after I had started shaking my fist at clouds, is talk about those folks that were the judges' choices for the Eisner Hall of Fame, right? Because unlike some of the voter choices, what happened was that they moved this particular portion of the Eisners, this Eisner Hall of Fame judges thing, to earlier in the morning. Like, it wasn't even part of the Eisner Award ceremony. It was like a separate ceremony, and they said they did that to get fans there, but at the time, nobody freaking covered it, which I was just like...
It's essentially like the governor's ball. It's become this is now the governor's ball for the Oscars, right? Where they give out all the technical awards, and there's only actually two awards that come with a trophy. Everything else comes with like a plaque or a plate. Or like a certificate.
You get a nice letter you can frame.
But that's what it felt like to me. And I felt like that was giving the short shrift to some of these folks that really, truly, you know, should have been, I don't know, treated better. I mean, half the list is like, unfortunately, deceased already, which...
Yes, that brings up the whole idea of who are these awards for? Are they for the people that they're giving them to? Okay, maybe if you're Gary Trudeau or Brian Boland, Jerry Conway, you know, you're alive, you can accept it. It means something. But for most of these other people, they've passed away, some of them decades ago. These awards are not for them. These awards are for us to make us feel better about not giving them an award before.
Wow, somebody just watched Oppenheimer. Jeez.
There you go.
Well, what did you think, Chad? What do you think of, like, the whole notion of them moving this and then nobody covered it?
Well, I watched Barbie instead of Oppenheimer, and all I can say is it's complicated. There's a lot of different expectations that people have that women should do this and not do that, and they should do this and they should not do that. And then poor Ken is out there, and Ken is frustrated because nobody notices Ken. He's just Ken, but he's Ken not.
Now, we're not getting there on the office and everything. Tangent. We are going to give these folks some credit. So on today's program, you can tune out if you want to, but we are going to talk real quickly about the judges' choices for the Eisner Hall of Fame. Because, again, a lot of folks don't even know anybody on this list. I think it's our opportunity to do some edumacation with those listeners out there. Because I know some of the names on this list, not just Gary Trudeau, because he won a Pulitzer. Damn it. So let's go ahead through the list a little bit, and we'll kind of talk about it. So the first person on the list was Jerry Bales. I knew him, at least from comic book history, as being the guy that started Alter Ego, which eventually Roy Thomas worked for and basically got Roy Thomas to get his job eventually at Marvel, because like he was writing for that fanzine and he was sending that fanzine out to Mort Weisinger and Julie Schwartz at DC, and then he was sending it to Stan at Marvel, and eventually he got hired. So like, if you didn't have Alter Ego, which is still going on, by the way, you wouldn't have Roy Thomas, who just gave us everything when it came to Marvel. Just tons of stuff. I don't know how you could be the father of comic book fandom, honestly, but like, if it hadn't been for Jerry Bales creating these like fanzines around comic books, we wouldn't have a job, because that's what we do with this silly podcast of ours.
So next up, we've got a Filipino comic book artist, Tony DeZuniga. Yeah, he really paved the way for a lot of Filipino artists in the early 70s to start coming over, whether you're talking about Alfredo Alcala or Ernie Chan or Wilson Protasio, just to name a few.
If you need to know anything about Tony, he co-created Jonah Hex. That says it in itself. Like, Jonah Hex, that's one of the most important comic book cowboys out there. So kudos to you, Tony. Up next is Justin Green, another one of those underground artists in the 1970s. Put together a bunch of books, such as Binky Brown Meets the Holy Virgin Mary, and Bijou Funnies, and Insect Fear, and a bunch of other ones. As somebody that's now started to really get into underground comics, like, I'm always seeking out those that were working in that medium in the 1970s, because they were really pushing the boundaries of what you could do with comics. Although I don't know much about Justin Green, I'll be definitely checking out his work now that he's been inducted into the Eisner Hall of Fame, for sure.
So next up, we had Jay Jackson, who was an African-American artist who spent many years working for the Chicago Defender, in addition to working as an illustrator for science fiction magazines such as Amazing Stories and Fantastic Adventures. He introduced the world to the first black superhero, Bungleton Green. So a very important man in terms of civil rights history and comic books. And another one that I think Eisners are trying to give credit to show, you know, these are some comics that probably a lot of the bulk of the comic reading country doesn't know about maybe as much. So I like that this is being highlighted, because it's groundbreaking work.
Yeah, absolutely. It's kind of like a couple of years ago when they inducted Matt Baker into the Eisner Hall of Fame. Like, a lot of folks didn't know about Matt Baker and how then that wonderful art that he had in the Golden Age. Kudos to the Eisner Hall of Fame for inducting another. And I've seen some of that work on Bungleton Green. It's good stuff. So you should check that out.
I was going to say, too, before we get on to the next one, that's one of the great parts about the whole Eisner milieu, is that they're teaching us, they're exposing fans, people like myself, that you know, I've been reading comic books for 40 years, and there's so much history that I've yet to be exposed to. And so I hadn't heard of Bungleton Green, or have I read any of the 70s underground comics we were talking about earlier. And so it really is nice to have these things highlighted as like, as just a reminder, like there's so much out there. We think, you know, you see the same things on the shelves week after week at your local comic shop. There's a whole history to explore.
Next up on the list is Wint Mortimer. Best thing that I can say about Wint Mortimer is the fact that he drew all of the Spidey Super Stories. Yes. And if you've ever read the Spidey Super Stories like I did, it's awesome. So I would put him in the Eisner Hall of Fame for the fact that he did Spidey Super. I mean, he did other things, honestly, but like Star Jaws.
Oh, not the Thanos copter?
No, Star Jaws. Dr. Doom built Death Star with a big mouth on it, and then fights Spider-Man with lightsabers.
Up next on the list is Gaspar Saladino, a letterer and a logo designer who's responsible for a ton of those logos that you're going to know from DC Comics and Marvel Comics, things like Swamp Thing and Vigilante and a bunch of others. Jay, help me out. What are some of the other logos?
Adam Strange, House of Mystery, House of Secrets. And then for Marvel, he did he updated the Avengers, Sergeant Fury and his Howling Commandos, Captain America and Falcon.
I know him best from the interiors on the 1970s Swamp Thing. So again, before the Alan Moore stuff, like when you were talking about the Len Wein and Bernie Wrightson, anytime you would see like the drippy letters, like that looked like they were just coming out of the swamp and all gross and goopy, like that was all him. Like they, so that's kind of cool. We don't talk enough about letterers. So kudos to Gaspar for getting a nod here. And the final one on the list of deceased inductees was Mort Walker, which I think I kind of like is, I don't want to say saving the best for last, but it's definitely the person that I think most people on the street would recognize Mort Walker's work, just simply because he was the guy that developed Beetle Bailey.
Well, didn't Beetle Bailey spin out of High and Lois?
Beetle Bailey was first. High and Lois spun out of Beetle Bailey.
Well, regardless, Beetle Bailey was, I think, Lois's brother. I think he's the uncle of the kids in High and Lois. It's funny, though, because Beetle Bailey didn't start off as a military comic strip. Like, Beetle Bailey was originally a college student for the first year. Then he got drafted into the army. And then they introduced Sarge and, like, Sarge's dog. And then it went from there. But I'm just glad, whether it's Mort Walker, whether it's Gary Trudeau, I'm just glad that they're including folks that did comic strips. Because honestly, like, even today, I feel like comic strips are the way that some folks get into comics, right? Like, even that, I don't know, the one with the aliens. What is that one?
Strange Planet.
There you go. Like, that's a way that people still get into comic books because they're looking at those strips online and they're like, oh, those are funny. And then the next thing that they know, they're picking up other comics or at least other web comics for sure. So kudos to them giving credit to comic strip folks, because I think it's important. Yeah, the last four inductees were all living. The first one is Bill Griffin. He did Zippy the Pinhead.
Was that a comic strip or was that an underground, like R. Crummy?
It was kind of like R. Crummy, but then it eventually was a strip. Like, it was definitely a strip for a while. And that's why, I'm glad that, like, strip folks are included in the Eisner Hall of Fame, because strips are important. They're no different than the books. So, meh. Then there's Gary Trudeau, and he did Doonesbury, won a Pulitzer. I didn't know that Doonesbury had an animated short film and a Broadway musical. Did you know that, Jay?
I did not know that there was a Broadway musical. I have to find the...
I want to know, what year did Doonesbury win the Pulitzer?
It won the Pulitzer in 1975.
Kudos to you, Gary. I guess I can't be snarky anymore when we mention your name. The next up is Jack Katz, who was born way back in 1927. He's actually one of the ones that I know the best on this entire list, because not only did he work doing Bullet Man in the Golden Age, which is one of the other Fawcett characters that folks don't know about. Like, everybody knows about Captain Marvel and Captain Marvel Jr. and Mary Marvel. But Bullet Man was also a really important character in Fawcett's, you know, collection of heroes, and is even in that Shazam Convergence story that I love so much, done by Jeff Parker with the awesome Doc Shaner art. Like, Bullet Man's all through that, and Bullet Girl.
He's one of the first public domain like characters that I can recall seeing. Like, there was a version of Bullet Man that showed up in G.I. Joe. There's a version of Bullet Man that showed up on The Tick. That guy's everywhere.
And I mean, he influenced so many characters. I mean, you look at Bullet Man, and then you look later on at, like, the Rocketeer, pretty much the same character, honestly. later on, Jack Katz went and worked for DC and Marvel. But the thing that I know him best of is something that I just recently discovered just this year was his first Kingdom project, which was like, for the time in the 1970s, like he really, you know, expanded what you could do with comic books and spent 12 years working on this like independent comic book, taking a post-apocalyptic society from like the early days when they were just cavemen fighting with dinosaurs all the way through all these different ages, this massive, massive story, which at the time...
It sounds epic. It's like man's migration into space, the ensuing galactic battles, and the great mystery of mankind's origin before the fall of civilization.
And they are so intricate. If you read one of his pages, it's like, I don't know, like 16 or 17 boxes all on the same page, and all of it is like small type, and yes, it's sometimes difficult to read, but just the amount of world building that this guy did with that first Kingdom series, it's impressive. I think at the time that it was coming out, even Will Eisner, who this wonderful award is named after, was like, people should be reading Jack Katz's stuff. So I'm glad that he got the award, to your point, J.A., before he was no longer with us, because he definitely deserved it, not to say anybody else. And finally, we've got Yana Wood, originally married to a very well-known comic book artist in Wallywood, and then went on to do extensive work as a comic book colorist. And she was one of the main colorists for so many iconic series, especially during the Grant Morrison era, such as like all of that work on Grant Morrison's Animal Man and Camelot 3000, and that unique look of all of the Alan Moore issues of Swamp Thing. Like when you look at the Anatomy Lesson and all of that, that's her colors.
She won the Shazam Award for Best Colorist in 1971 and 74. And that was when she was at DC really doing, I mean, the bulk of the covers for all of DC Comics at that time.
So, yeah, that's our list of the folks that were inducted into the Hall of Fame, the judges' choices. Hopefully you learned something from today's history lesson. Any case, after these commercial breaks, we're going to have an interview with Tom Peyer, who is the current editor-in-chief over at Ahoy Comics. He's going to be talking about not only their upcoming five-year anniversary, but he'll also be talking about his work on The Wrong Earth. So stay tuned for that.
Hey, it's Mikey Wood, frequent Last Comic Shop guest and collector. And as a collector, I'm always in need of boards, bags, long boxes, and more to house all those comics. That's why I use promo code LCSPOD to get 10% off my orders at bcwsupplies.com. Not only does it get me a discount on BCW's already low prices, but I know using LCSPOD at checkout is another way I can show my support to the Last Comic Shop podcast and their continuing mission to bring fans together under that big comic book tent. So if you're in need of comic book supplies, head out to bcwsupplies.com and use promo code LCSPOD today. That's LCSPOD.
Hi, and welcome to The Capsule Life, a show for the most casual and dedicated fans of comics and a member of the Comic Watch family. I'm your host, Sean. Join me and discover what the world of comics and graphic novels have to offer. From one-on-one interviews with industry professionals, roundtable discussions with passionate fans, and reviews on the latest comics, TV shows, and movies. You can also check out our website, www.thecaptionlife.com, to find out where you can listen to us, a list of all of our episodes, and where you can find us on social media under the username at Caption Life. You'll get a new episode from us every week, so hit the subscribe button so you don't miss out.
All right, we're back with more of The Last Comic Shop, and we are talking with Tom Peyer. Hey, Tom.
Did you have an R in there? It's Peyer, not Pryor.
I said Peyer.
I heard Richard Pryor.
That's because you got Silver Streak on the brain. It is a good movie. But hi, Tom. Well, thanks for dropping by The Last Comic Shop. We're huge fans of your work, whether it was, you know, previously with DC and Marvel, or now with just being the editor-in-chief of Ahoy Comics. I mean, we've loved so many books that Ahoy has put out over the last 5 years. And so having you on the show is just a tremendous honor, sir. So thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you. I'm a huge fan of the way you just shouted my name. I felt like a very exciting person when you did that.
Yeah, well, I try to give folks the Kermit the Frog treatment once in a while. You know, I think you do that. So, Tom, one of the questions we often like to ask folks that stop by the Last Comic Shop is you as a comic book fan. It's an opportunity for some of our listeners that have been comic book fans either for just a few weeks or for a long, long time to hear about, like, what was the first comic book you remember getting?
It's Superman Volume 1, number 140. And
okay.
It's a story called The Son of Bizarro, a thrilling three-part novel written by, I think it was Jerry Siegel, drawn by Wayne Boren. And
okay.
It was just the most, I mean, it just takes your heart and squeezes all the blood out of it.
Oh,
it is an extremely heavy and moving story that has to do with issues of child custody and suicide. I mean, I'm 6 years old.
Right.
Wow.
And
that's Bizarro.
It's
not
just
expecting that out of Bizarro.
It is the heaviest story I had read to that point, and maybe to this point.
Wow. Because when I often ask this question to folks, like, that first comic book, the thing that, like, kind of catapulted them on this lifelong journey of being a comic book fan, it really oftentimes does mean quite a lot. And it seems like this one definitely did. I have not read this particular issue, but now I will have to go and pick it up.
Oh, you'll have
this,
to.
This glowing. Is Wayne your favorite, your iconic Superman artist, or?
He's one of them. I mean, he was the first one I saw. So, but also Kurt Swan was doing, even when he was drawing the book, Kurt Swan was doing these beautiful covers that not only got me interested in Superman, but got me interested in drawing. I would just lay on my stomach on the floor and just, like, copy his covers over and over.
Wow.
That's awesome. So as a comic creator, have you always wanted to be a writer? Did you want to be an artist too? Or what got you into that mode?
I think I wanted to be an artist, but it's so hard.
It takes so much more time.
So I took,
like,
the easy
too
route.
Much work, please.
I took the easy bottom feeding lazy route and became a writer.
Well, I don't know if I would go that far, because you eventually ended up becoming a publisher, and you have to deal with all the day-to-day stuff going on. So that can't be the easy route for sure.
Right.
Well, editor, I mean, we do have a publisher who's like a different guy, but I know what you mean. Yeah, yeah, it's a small company, and I find myself doing things I haven't done before.
Well, speaking, I guess, of being a writer and an editor, one of the questions I had is, because again, you've done a lot of both. Is there one that you prefer than the other? Like, do you prefer editing other people's work, or do you like
the variety of having both in my life?
Oh, okay.
Like, I didn't. There was a long, long stretch where I was not at all an editor in any sense of the word. I was just writing, and that was great. But I do like the idea of feeling just being part of something bigger than just my own stories.
Right.
Right. And your credits run the gamut from, you know, Spider-Man to Justice Society to Batman 66.
And Our Man. Ah, I liked your run on Our Man, where he was
Thanks.
The android from the future and the snapper car and all that. That was good stuff.
That was the first time I felt like I might know what I'm doing.
How did that idea come about, by the way?
Grant Morrison. He came up with with that character for Justice League.
And
it was, I think it was Grant's idea that I write a series of it. And he sent me an email that was like a paragraph long that had some of the ideas for a setup that I ended up using.
Okay.
It was just a great gift from him, that book.
Oh, yeah. He's an idea machine, Grant Morrison. Right.
Yes, he is. Yes, he is. And he was a very generous one in my case.
Yeah. He was kind of like, I have this idea, but I don't have time to write it. You write it, Tom.
Just saw me just sitting there like a lump, not doing anything, and said, I'm going to come up with something for Tom to do.
Oh, well, that's nice of him.
I think that's my theory anyway.
That's your theory. So, yeah, in terms of being the editor-in-chief at Ahoy, another question that I had is, I've always found the title of editor-in-chief to be like,
I don't know how to explain it. Like, you know, when I was growing up in the 80s and I was reading Marvel comics, the editor in chief was Jim Shooter, right? Mm-hmm. Like Jim Shooter was, his name was in everything. He steered that company into a lot of great stuff. And I always, I don't put him on a pedestal because I thought he had like, he was not only, you know, writing his own books, but he was creating this massive universe out there. Do you feel like that same, feeling at Ahoy?
No.
Like the, No, not at all.
Not at all. I got to choose my title, and I chose editor in chief only because of Perry White.
Oh,
great Caesar's ghost.
We've had other people edit our books, and I try not to interfere with them very much.
Oh, okay.
I like to have creative people on board who are doing what they want to do and not being told all the time what to do.
And that is a hallmark of Ahoy Comics. You guys get some of the best creators coming through to write and draw these books. And so I'm curious, like the whole Ahoy mentality with the extra text pages, you know, the prose and the poetry and all that stuff, and how sometimes those will show up in the individual issues, but not in the collected editions. What's some of the thought process behind that stuff? Like what inspired you guys to go that route?
When I was a kid, I could always tell the difference between a generous package and a stingy package. As the package got stingier and stingier, I would resent it. So I always felt like we need to just give something extra. Also, you know, I mean, we were looking around for things to do, and I don't know if you know this, but the reason we had letter pages is because publishers could save a lot of money by including text in a comic book. They were then considered a legitimate magazine if it had text in it. So it would get
reduced
postal rates.
Mail classifications, yeah.
Right. Back when people like subscribed through the mail. And before they thought of letter columns, they used to have stories, prose stories in them.
Right. Yeah.
In fact, Stan Lee's first job was a Captain America prose story. And these stories were written as fast as possible for as little pay as possible.
Is that still the Ahoy?
I have seen, I've seen a million of them, and I don't think I ever finished one. So the thinking for Ahoy was, we were looking at this and we thought, what if these were good? So that's the experiment. Can you do this and have it be good? And I think we do. But the other thing about those prose features in the back of our books is if you're going to pay for a comic book, you know, it ain't 10 cents no more, or a quarter or 50 cents. We want you for your whole lunch hour. We don't want you to just, like, read it in 5 minutes and, you know, not have anything to do.
No, it's true. There are some comic books I'll pick up, and I'll be able to say whether it was a good or a bad one, whether or not I finish it on the John. Like if I'm like, boy, that took me 3 minutes to read because mostly it was splash pages and not really there wasn't, and it just continues in the next thing. I'm like, well, I don't know if that was worth my money. Honestly, I would rather it be something with a little more substantial. And to your point, I actually didn't know that's why they included those prose things in those Golden Age covers. I'll get those collections sometimes in like omnibuses, and they'll have those. And you're right, I skip over them because I'm like, they're not very well written. It was just because of the postal rate, the same reason that they eventually, you're teaching me there, Tom.
And I think that was, I mean, it had to be the original letter pages too. That's just another way. Oh, we can fill this page for free.
There you go. And it's definitely additive. I've never, felt shortchanged from an Ahoy book. And for me personally, I'm a big Mark Russell fan. So when he came over with Second Coming, I hopped over and started reading some Ahoy books. I read Hashtag Danger whenever that was coming out, The Wrong Earth.
Thanks.
All those books, and they're all great. They're all really substantial too. And I like your philosophy there of, you know, having that extra value. Outside of your own work, is there anything that Ahoy has published that you look at and say, I was really, you feel really great about giving that a platform?
Oh, I have to say all of it. I mean, that's a mealy answer, but
yeah,
it wouldn't be there if we didn't love it.
You know, right. You guys seem to pick up the slack from Vertigo, whenever Vertigo changed to the Black Label and stopped doing
creative
stuff.
Well, I worked at Vertigo. So,
yeah.
And that's where I learned everything that I know, working for Karen Berger.
And, right.
Because you did what? You did Sandman work. You did Shade the Changing Man, didn't you?
Yeah, that's right. That's right. I was the assistant editor on those and Hellblazer, and I got to be the editor of my then favorite comic book, Doom Patrol.
Oh yes,
and yeah. And I got to share an office with Karen for a year, and that is when you really learn. That was like 4 years in college because I could see how she dealt with, you know, artists and writers. I was right there for it. I could, how she would deal with various problems that came up. And I just learned, she was so terrific. And I learned so much.
Do you recall like a particular interaction that you thought you just marveled at how Karen had handled that? You don't have to name any names of what, who happened with, but.
No, it's really just more like an endless haze of competence.
Well, yeah, Karen Berger is definitely great. And the quality of stuff that Vertigo was able to put out, you know, month after month for years.
Unbelievable.
It's just astounding. Yeah.
Unbelievable. I mean, she inherited Swamp Thing.
Right.
And then with Hellblazer, she turned it into a line. I mean, it went from being one comic book to like the foundation of something huge.
Right. With Books of Magic and all those great books at that time.
Yeah.
It was a fertile time. One of our frequent guests, Mikey Wood, that's his absolute favorite comic book universe, is that Vertigo line. But speaking of comic book universes, Ahoy has a great one that starts it off with one of your books that you wrote, which is Wrong Earth. I wanted to talk about that one because I'm a huge fan of that book. I thought it was marvelous when I first read it. And I reread it right before this interview. And where did the idea to do like pretty much like the Adam West Batman and like the dark and gritty Batman swapping places and being in different universes, like where did that all come from?
Well, first of all, I'm not familiar with this Batman you're but where it came from was having read comic books for a very long time, and when I was younger, they all the superheroes were like sort of flag saluting Boy Scouts, and then not just Batman, but all of them. And at a certain point, a switch got flicked and they all became like vengeance seeking badasses.
Right.
Which is a very different thing. So you could look at, I was thinking about how you could look at a superhero chess symbol in a certain part of history and it all means one set of values. And you can look at the same symbol 20 years later and it means an entirely different set of values.
On that, that's reflected in the brilliance of The Wrong Earth with your different characters, and you show those, the visual aspects and how they change and how they get darker and like what aspects are more hidden, and it's just, it's brilliant stuff.
I appreciate that. Thank you. I love working on that book. It's one of my favorite things ever, and Jamal Igle has brought so much to it creatively. I hope people know that. I mean, it was his idea to use dragonflies, for instance.
Okay.
It would not have come out half as well if he hadn't been involved.
And he really does such a great job of capturing both, you know, the Silver Age essence of those characters versus the modern grim and gritty, like post-1986 comic book worlds.
So when you were populating those two universes, to talk a little bit more about that, how did you come up with the bad guy? And I think it's amazing how, like, the Dragonfly character goes back, spoiler alert, he goes back, they swap places and they do fairly well because they're both fairly competent people and they, mm-hmm. they figure out the each other's universes. But basically the bad guy from the Silver Age universe gets to the gritty and is immediately dispatched, like, with no question. Like, was that?
Yeah, I think they find him in a garbage can, if I remember right. Yeah.
So how did that, like, how did the thought process of the bad guys, especially like Deuce, who ends up being a very, very interesting character from that universe and taking no guff from anybody, if filling in those gaps in the universe, how do you go about something like that?
Well, the villain's name is Number One. And mm-hmm. for some reason, something was happening in the world that made me very interested in narcissism.
I can't imagine.
So it was kind of like my way of working out some problems with that, to center a character in narcissism. But it's also a great contrast from the selflessness of the heroes, you know. As far as Deuce is concerned, who ends up being Lady Dragonfly Man as the series progresses, mm-hmm. but, She's totally from the Batman TV show, I will confess, because not only did they have Catwoman, but they had every villain had like a mom.
Yeah.
It was always a woman who, like, the Joker was apparently dating for this episode, who would be there and be part of the criminal scheme. And so it really felt like we needed a character like that, but one who would advance more into the foreground. Because at first she would be just like a shortchanged by number one's narcissism, but she would have to conquer that.
I love the scene where she's in court and she convinces the judge, you know, to let her go. And all these guys need to come with me or I'll be all alone. And he turns to him and is like, you're my goons now. But no, I wanted to talk a little bit. The Batman 66 TV show obviously must have made a huge impression on you, as it did for me growing up. But I can tell how you, at least from my perspective, it seems as though you really respect the fun and the spirit of that show in a way that not a lot of comic creators, I think, always get. What specifically made that Batman 66 ethos so wonderful, as opposed to, you know, how you balance that with all the modern grim and gritty stuff?
It was a wonderful show. It was so entertaining and so funny. And what it doesn't get credit for, it was really anti-authority in a way that most television wasn't back then. But everyone in a position of authority in that show is markedly inferior to Batman, and they know it. And they tend to be pretty incompetent generally. So if you combine that with the sort of like aggressive art direction, the way the show looked, it's a really 60s show.
Yeah.
In a way that I think it doesn't really get a lot of credit for. But
right, it's very artful.
It's also just so funny and so entertaining and so well performed. I get a sick amount of pleasure out of watching Neil Hamilton as Commissioner Gordon. I think he is so funny all the time. And he's probably the most gifted comedian on the show, except Adam West is brilliant, of course. And yeah. I don't know. I just love it. I didn't love it when I first saw it. I was 12 years old. And
okay.
I thought they might be making fun of Batman. I just turned a switch in my head. It's like, this is Batman on TV. This is never going to happen again in my lifetime. I'm going to enjoy this. I just brainwashed myself into liking it like a Trump voter.
I think they had me the very first episode with the Riddler and one of his goons is the girl who dresses up like Robin. And in one scene, they show her and then she like shakes her head. Then all of a sudden, it's Burt Ward.
Burt Ward.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
Just the absurdity of that camera switch. Like, I was like, no, this is for me.
Is that the same episode where Batman goes to the bar and he's like, he's at the bar and he's like, I'll have a glass of milk? Or is that?
Absolutely.
Oh, man. See, it doesn't get as much credit as things like another great show from that era is the Avengers. And everyone's like, oh, the Avengers is so cool and all this other stuff. But Batman was cool too, like in its own way. And so
really cool.
And I'm glad that you kind of weave all of that into The Wrong Earth, honestly. Like one of my favorite scenes in The Wrong Earth is when all the other baddies from the Silver Age universe, Society of Evil or whatever, they put them in the big,
the piggy bank
or something. Oh, yeah. And he very easily gets out of it and just goes, what are you people doing with your lives? Like, what was the purpose of this? Like, do you have a purpose? And then they all existentially like start questioning. Yeah, well, maybe he's right. Like, maybe we should do something else.
And I love too, like, it's not malice. Like, even in the criminals, like there's a wholesomeness there. Like, you juxtapose the banker and the police commissioner between the two Earths, and in the one, you know, there are all these terrible things that they had done, and then meanwhile in the 60s universe, like, they're just there. They just want, you know, Dragonfly Man to solve their crimes.
Yeah, it's more like a game.
Yeah, there isn't that maliciousness that, you know, you see so often in the modern books. There's a certain purity to it.
Right.
I
don't want you to think I'm taking sides in The Wrong Earth. I mean, both approaches have very good things about them.
Right. You are very fair to both sides. And again, part of the best thing about this book, if you haven't read it, because Dragonfly Man is so competent, he's just able to go to a different universe and just adapt to those rules. And actually not only adapt, but thrive. It's almost like this other universe was kind of waiting for a character kind of like that, and how those opposites kind of attract in those different universes. So did that thought process come into play when you were like, wow, like the 60s Silver Age character would actually do really well?
Dragonfly Man has rough moments. He does kind of bottom out in the middle of the first series there. But he
figures it out.
Yeah. He figures it out. He gets extremely depressed and then cheers himself up by beating up a bunch of bad guys.
And I love the sound effects as he's beating them up. And it's like, you can tell he's in his element. Like,
oh, that's right. He's saying the sound effects.
Yeah. Right.
Dragonfly can't believe his luck in a way. He's gone to this place where the danger is so much less. And the cops don't seem to be crooked at all. I think he really learns to enjoy the place.
Oh yeah, it's like a vacation for him. And yeah, there's that chilling scene at the end of book one where basically, you know, those same stooge crooks, bad guys that show up and try to ruin him, you know, some sort of press conference or something. And they're actually about to kill his sidekick, like, or hit him with a hammer at least. And he's like, oh no, this is getting out too serious. The 86 is the guy, because he's just like, no, like, I'm all about playing this game, but the moment you're actually going to get serious about this stuff, no, like, I'm gonna tramp this down.
Partner's like, but Dragonfly Man, you killed that guy. And he's like, no, I sent him to witness protection. Obviously, yeah, that's all a ruse. I'm like, oh, I love this.
Yeah, he'll get away with what he can when no one's looking.
Right. So yeah, huge fans of Wrong Earth, and again, that was one of the first comic books that Ahoy came out with, correct?
Like that was the first one, yeah, okay. the very first.
And I guess that's my where I want to pivot to is, here you are working for DC Marvel, a journeyman working in comics for many, many years. What brought you to Ahoy? Like, why Ahoy? Like, what did you want to do? What were you trying to do different, I guess?
Well, here in Syracuse, New York, two very, very good friends of mine that I've been friends with for decades. They both worked for the local daily paper. And as you know, most people who did don't anymore.
Yeah. My father-in-law, he was fortunate to retire from the newspaper business, but he had a lot of friends that didn't get that opportunity.
Hart Seeley was a reporter. Frank Camuso was their editorial cartoonist, brilliant cartoonist. They were rooting around for something to do. Hart found some sources of money to start something. Hart read comics when he was a kid. He can talk to you about The Flash, but he wasn't really a comic book person in adult life. Frank and I were total comic book beasts. It was Hart's idea to start a comic book company, the three of us. So in our ignorance, we did, with absolutely no inkling of how hard it would be, but we're glad we did it.
And you're coming up on your 5-year anniversary. Like, these have been a very interesting 5 years. What's it been like navigating the waters through all of the craziness that's going on in the world in the publishing industry?
Yeah, the pandemic was a huge one. We actually had to stop publishing for a few months because everybody had to stop publishing because there was no distributor.
Right. I had a comic shop near me that stayed open, and it was like going to a speakeasy.
Unbelievable.
Yeah.
Not three times. What's the password?
Well, for a while it was very good for retail stores because people weren't going to conventions, so they would sort of spend some of that money at the comic book store.
Has that spilled over? Do you still have the people hooked that are coming back to Ahoy Books that started picking them up during the pandemic? Or
it's very difficult from where I sit to know who's picking it up and why. And if they did last month, or if it's a different person, I have absolutely no information about that. No way to get it.
All right. So, but you do have, as we mentioned earlier, an incredible roster of creative folks that work, that put out books through Ahoy. What would you say to comic creators that are looking for an outlet to get their work out there? Why should they go Ahoy, Ahoy, Ahoy?
We look for ideas that have some depth to them, but when you hear them, you can see kind of why they're funny too.
Okay.
Humor is very important to us. I don't know if it really comes across that well, but every single Ahoy comic is trying to be funny on some level. They're not all comedies, but you can't show me one that takes itself entirely seriously. And that's deliberate. We want everything to be at least a little funny.
Right. As a Mark Russell fan, like, he has that satire, that social satire that is just brilliant.
Yeah.
And he brings it 17 different ways through My Bad or Second Coming, where he's taking on religion, or Billionaire Island, all the wealth inequality and all that other stuff.
Right. I don't know if you'll, but I feel sometimes like Ahoy is kind of like the modern day EC Comics, in which basically, you know, you're out there putting out titles that, sure, they may have science fiction on the cover, or they might have horror on the cover, but, like, for example, like they like to do in every single sci-fi, they always put that twist in, they always try to put that social commentary in, they always try to put something that went, oh, okay, I see what they're doing here, and that kind of wink and nod to those longtime fans. So, like, again, kudos to you for kind of filling that hole, because like EC Comics back in the day, like, it's important that independent comic book and just comic book companies in general have an outlet where, again, you may be getting something because of superheroes, but you're getting a little bit more because of the creative input of folks like you, Tom.
I could listen to you talk about me all day.
And you have.
That is true. So let's real quickly, let's wrap up by saying for the 5-year anniversary that's coming up this September, October, what comic books are coming out from Ahoy in the next couple of months that you might want to kind of just plug a little bit so that folks know to pick them up?
Well, as far as the 5th anniversary goes, we're going to be announcing some titles and specials soon. Project Cryptid is setting it off, and that's our new anthology edited by Sarah Litt, and just with the greatest creators like Mark and Paul Cornell. And it's what it sounds like, is an anthology of like characters like Bigfoot and the Jersey Devil and all the stuff that you either can believe in or don't. But we're also kicking off the 5th anniversary with something Stuart Moore has organized, and it's really great. It's a 13-part, I think, round robin prose story. That's going to be, chapter one is by Grant Morrison, and it's going to be in Project Cryptid number one. Wow. And then we'll take it through 12 more chapters by 12 different writers. And at the end, we'll see if it makes any sense at all. And I read the first chapter, and it doesn't, believe me. It's great.
The first chapter doesn't make sense. You think you got to lay the foundation?
Not at all. Not at all. But it's terrific. It's a beautifully terrific, absurd piece of writing by Grant.
And that's awesome. So is it, you know, the writer writes you into a corner, and the next guy has to pick it up?
Has to pick it up. Ah. Got to see their pants. Yep, absolutely.
We love those books. They've been doing that on Daredevil for a really long time. Like, they'll just be like, hey, I'm going to kill off Daredevil or put him in jail or whatever. Yeah, you can figure it out from there. It's amazing how the next writer's like, okay. Oh, you think you're painting me into a corner? No, no, no. You see what I'm going to do. So I like that approach. It's challenging. It's challenging as a...
I want to mention the artist John Proctor, too, who's wonderful and underrated and not famous enough. And he's doing illustrations for all of these that are just eyeball blasting.
Very cool. Like half-page illustrations or like full-page
illustrations? Well, depending on... The size always depends on the word count. It can vary.
Okay. I was just curious because I will say that when there were those prose things, I did look at the illustrations because it was still a comic book. So like,
we have good,
I was always like looking for the next picture.
We have good pictures on those.
Oh, you definitely
a really nice bunch of, we get to work with Rick Geary, who I worship. I don't know if you remember him from National Lampoon days.
Yes. Yes, I do.
He's amazing. And there's a lot of good stuff there.
Very cool. All right. Well, thank you so much for stopping by the Last Comic Shop. Tom, where can everybody find Ahoy Comics? Like, not only in your shops, but like social media wise, where can folks find Ahoy Comics?
Well, if you go to Evil Twitter, we're at Ahoy Comic Mags, and I'm at Tom Peyer. We can just sort of huddle there against the onslaught of
there you go.
People who want to destroy us.
We certainly do at the Last Comic Shop. So again, Tom, thank you so much for taking some time with us today and stopping by the shop. We hope to have you back soon. talk about some of these projects that are coming up. And again, folks that are out there, make sure that you, if you see Ahoy on the cover, that you're picking it up, because that is a fantastic comic book company. And we love so much great work that comes out of them, that we're fans and we'll be fans for years to come. So thank you again, Tom.
And thank you.
Thanks so much for coming by. And yeah, there's 5 years worth of back catalog from Ahoy Comics. There's so many great books in there. You could start with The Wrong Earth. You could go Second Coming. You could, if you, like Andy was saying, if you see Ahoy.
What's Bronze Age?
Bronze Age Boogie.
Oh, Bronze Age Boogie. Yes.
That's a great book.
That book is nuts.
That got me from the cover. I was just like, what is going on here? I have to get this.
You know what I think? This world we're in right now is the fairy tale. And what's really real is on the other side.
Ramsey, mechanic by day, aspiring comic book creator by night, went into the woods and tripped. He was bombarded by bizarre and mysterious glyphs that he drew into his sketch pad and onto the body of his muse, Regina.
Oh, Groovy, your art is crawling all over me.
Shit, what is going on with you?
What's going on with you? All of a sudden, you're a complete drip, baby. Maybe you need another limb to the head. Ah!
Bloom, written and created by Ted Sikora, with art by Butch Mappa.
How are you feeling, Ram Man?
You've never experienced a story so astonishing, so far out and away from the beaten path.
Where in the am I?
Blast off with Bloom, the origin of a prophet. Order yours at herotomorrow.com.
All right, we're back with more of The Last Comic Shop, and thank you so much to Tom Peyer for being on our show. And speaking of great comic books, like the ones that Tom Peyer has been responsible for over the years, it's now time for recommendations. Yes, that time of every single show where we give you other comic books in addition to The Wrong Earth, which we hope that you pick up, based on not only our glowing recommendation in the previous segment, but also the fact that Tom Peyer is a great guy. And you should support Ahoy Comics wherever you can find them. So, yeah, we're going to go ahead and start off with J.A. Scott this week. So, J.A., what is your recommendation for this week?
I am recommending a very interesting run on Silver Surfer by George Perez writing, with pencils by Tom Grindberg and inks by Bill Anderson. It is called the Unilord Saga. It ran from Silver Surfer 111 through Silver Surfer 121. Basically, George Perez took over the book for a year, and this was the major storyline that he did. Silver Surfer crosses over into another dimension to save this other complete universe that's being taken over by this Dark Lord, who's kind of like Galactus. He comes down and he absorbs an entire species, except for one person who gets absorbed into this mass consciousness. And throughout the story, Norrin Rad is absorbed, but the Silver Surfer part of him breaks away. And so Norrin Rad is part of this mass consciousness, but he's trying to fight from the inside, while the Silver Surfer, the body is chopped up into 12 pieces and given out to 12 different people who then become Silver Surfers.
Oh,
and
that's so
there's
cool.
Like 12 different silver, and they're all these weird creatures. Like there's this thing that kind of looks like a giant gumdrop, and there's a little insect Silver Surfer, and there's a crab woman Silver Surfer who is a princess in her land. And it's just George Perez playing with toys. It's almost like an Elseworld story, since it's set outside of the Marvel continuity and the Marvel 616, but you get some great Silver Surfer in there. And it was a real fresh take on the book, because we had had a long run with Ron Mars and Ron Lim, and then they had some sort of filler issues in, and this was George Perez taking over and kind of putting his stamp on the Silver Surfer for a year. So I recommend, it's called the Unilord Saga. Again, Silver Surfer Volume 3 ran from issues 111 to 121.
There you go. And that is a kind of like a part of the Silver Surfer run, that Volume 3, which kind of everybody that grew up in the 80s and the 90s knows about. But it was like, it was again, post-Ron Lim, so some folks fell off the book, so they may not have been buying it. So they might not be aware that there was that kind of cool year-long storyline with multiple Silver Surfer people. That's still a neat concept. I love that. All right, Chad, what was your recommendation this week?
Okay, since we just had Tom Peyer on, which, by the way, if you are a Batman 66 fan, you need to be checking out The Wrong Earth. That series was delightful. But I thought I would celebrate Ahoy by recommending the first book that really caught my attention from Ahoy. And it's been continuing in various formats over these last couple of years. But it's Second Coming by Mark Russell, with art by Richard Pace and Leonard Kirk, where basically God is sending Jesus back for his second go-round, but he's decided he needs some guidance. He needs somebody to show him, you know, how things really work. And so he sends him down with a Superman analog named Sunstar, and hilarity ensues. And so you guys know I'm a big Mark Russell fan. We had a chance to talk to him a little bit ago. I didn't get into his theological background, which I regret. But all of that comes into play in the Second Coming series. The satire is sharp and bludgeoning at times when it needs to be, but the jokes are great and the message is on point. And it really is one of those comics that, you know, it makes you think and makes you appreciate the fact that there are comic books like that out there. And there are companies like Ahoy that are willing to take a chance on this book that was going to be Vertigo, but because of controversies, it got scuttled elsewhere, and, you know, Ahoy came in and made it happen. Then it's continuing, like I said, to make that happen, as well as other great books. So, yeah, Second Coming, check out the three volumes there. Check out the rest of the Ahoy library as they're celebrating their anniversary. You know, thanks again to Tom Peyer. It was great fun.
All right. And my recommendation goes hand in hand with the other topic that we had on today's program, which is the Eisner Awards. And every single time I think of the Eisner Awards, I think back to when I was, you know, growing up and those kind of books that first made me aware of the Eisner Awards and what a prestigious honor that was. And one of those series is that won a lot of Eisner Awards back in the day was Astro City, by Kurt Busiek, Brett Anderson, and Alex Ross. And one of the first books that really captured my imagination when it came to Astro City was a book called Confession, which is really, in essence, a portmanteau, which is just a fancy way of saying that they rearrange all the faces and give them all another name. The Confessor is the Batman of the Astro City universe, a dark Avenger of the night. And as he takes a new sidekick who is your audience surrogate throughout the entire story, that audience surrogate, that Robin type character, finds that this hero is truly a dark, dark character and has some secrets that he would rather keep from the general public. At the same time, there are aliens trying to take over the world. And again, if you've never read any Astro City, some folks may think it's just like, hey, you could tell these same stories with the Avengers or Superman or Batman or whatever. But really, Kurt was able to take all of that great continuity that came from DC and Marvel and just get to the core of why these characters are engaging, why these characters are great, put them all in the same universe and tell fantastic stories. So if you've never read any Astro City, I think that Confession is a really good place to start. And not only is it a great story, but it also won the Eisner Award for Best Serialized Story in 1998. So it's got some pedigree behind it as well. In any case, some pedigree that we hope that you take advantage of every single week is our episodes of The Last Comic Shop. We think we're a fantastic comic book podcast, and we hope that you come back for more episodes in the next couple of weeks, because we've got some great ones lined up for you. Not only do we have some movie reviews / comic book reviews, such as Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles Mutant Mayhem and the Blue Beetle movie, but we've got some great interviews with some Eisner Award winning writers and artists, such as P. Craig Russell in an upcoming episode, a whole hour with Roy Thomas. So make sure that you're rate, reviewing, and subscribing to our fantastic podcast so you don't miss any of the rest of the summer.
We also love talking about the Eisners, and we love recommending other books, including Silver Surfer, the Uni Lord Saga, featuring writing by George Perez. That was issues 111 to 121 out of volume 3. Or you could check out Second Coming by Mark Russell, Leonard Kirk, and Richard Pace. That is an Ahoy book out there. Or you could go back to the early Astro City days and check out Confessions. All that and more is available at your local comic shop. Don't know where they are? Check out the comic shop locator at www.comicshoplocator.com.
And if you want more coverage of comic books and all things comic related, you can always check out our website. We've got links to all our social media. We have polls on Twitter, got Golden Age comic book covers to tuck you into bed at night. Always links to our merch store. If you've got a friend or fan in the house that loves comics, buy him a t-shirt, buy him a hat, buy him a tote bag. So the next time he's at a con, he's got something to put all those back issues in. All that can be found, of course, at our website, www.lastcomicshoppodcast.com. Not to be confused with The Last Comic Shop, which is actually a comic shop. We're just a podcast. Sometimes we get people reaching out. What are your hours? Are you open today? We are not that.
We're always open, baby.
That's right.
We're always open on the internet.
And we hope you come back to The Last Comic Shop next week. We're going to be reviewing Infinity Gauntlet, which, again, is a very popular book. So make sure that you're tuning in for that awesome review. Until then, I was the host of
the
most...
Hey, look, Jay's got the glove. Jay, what are you doing with that glove? Jay, don't snap! Don't!
Why'd you snap away, Chad? This is the host of Most Danny Larson. I'm joined by Chad Smith. He's somewhere. And J.A. Scott. Oh, boy. I hope that Chad appears for next week. Maybe we can get Mikey Wood. I don't know. Until then, stay safe, stay cool. And remember, best thing that you can call a boat that has a hole in the bottom of it is a sink.
Wish I could snap away those jokes.
Was a 2023 Black Angus production.